morning, Union Church. All right, you're awake. You're ready to go. I'm going to go ahead and stand up, and we're going to just start off by singing it's kind of an older song called He Reigns. And it paints an awesome picture of God's people just singing, glory, glory, hallelujah, He Reigns. And it just reminds us one day what heaven is going to be like. So let's go ahead and get started this morning by just showing God, hey, we are ready to do whatever you want at any point in time. It's the song of the redeemed, rising from the African faith. And it's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born, grateful choir. I pray that all God's people this morning are ready and just waiting to hear from you. You are good. You deserve it all. Lord, let your spirit remain and guide every aspect of this service. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. Welcome to Union Church. It's great to see everybody here today, and especially if you're visiting with us, please be our guest. Welcome to our home, and we hope that you feel at home worshiping with us. And just know, if you're visiting or a guest today, we don't expect anything from you. We just hope to be able to give to you and that you feel welcome. So welcome to Union Church, those guests and visitors and our regular attenders. It's good to see everybody this morning. Just a couple of announcements before we continue on with the service today. First of all, I'd like to remind you that we have a church app that you can get if you're smart enough to have a smartphone. I don't know if that really is true or not, but if you have a smartphone, you can download an app called Church Center, and they tell me that if you download that app and you're in this place, our church will come up, and it's really easy. But if you're not here and you download it, just look for Union Church. There's a lot of ways you can interact. You can sign up for things. You can sign up. People have signed up for the newcomers lunch that we're having next Sunday. And it's great. We've got about 7 new families that are going to be coming to that lunch. And along with elders and everybody, we're going to have over 50 people at the newcomers lunch next Sunday, which I am just so excited about that that's happening here right after second service. A couple other announcements. We have a fish fry coming up here. And if you're not aware of that, most people are. That is a fundraiser for the Bible Trailers here in Huntington County. And what an amazing ministry that is. How many of you went to Bible Trailer when you were... Wow, about half of the people. Harold, you went to Bible Trailer? Wow, okay. Oh, they came in. Okay, so it wasn't really a trailer at that point. So, all right, but that is a fundraiser, and it's a great annual thing that we do here at Union Church. And there'll be volunteers that are going to be calling you. If you have volunteered and have worked at the fish fry in the past, you'll be getting a call this week from volunteers to see if you can help again. So they're getting that team together. We also need pies made, and there's a sign-up sheet in the office, or you can go on the church app and sign up that way. And finally, we're getting close to Christmas, which is amazing. And there are shoe boxes. We do this every year in the exits and entrances here. So if you normally do that, please pick up a shoe box. And you can do that to minister to children around the world this year. So those are the announcements that I have. Just a reminder that we have offering boxes in the corners as you come in and leave. So please leave your offering there. And again, if you're a guest and a first-timer, we don't expect anything from an offering for you today. Just be our guest today. So let's pray for the service and the offering. Heavenly Father, thank you so much that you are here with us. Lord, as your people gather together, the Holy Spirit comes and ministers. And so, Lord, we ask for the Holy Spirit just to come and be in this place. Lord, that your presence would be here, and we would sense that you're here, and that you would touch your people today. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
You please stand if God is leading you to do that this morning. As we start off singing, Great Are You, Lord, and I just pray that no matter what type of week or month or year you've had, that you can genuinely say that Great Are You, Lord, because even despite the crazy chaos that is happening in our world today, God is good and he is great and he is getting us through every single day. Amen? Let us praise him. This next song is called Battle Belongs, and it's just another good song to just declare that no matter what we're going through, because we all got crap, we've all got struggles, we've all got stuff that we are constantly going through, and sometimes it just wears on us. Sometimes we're just like, what's the point? If my life is going to be just as messed up as everyone else's, God, why am I even following you? Because at the end of the day, God has already won the battle. You know, we might still fail from time to time, but at the end of the day, we know that God has won the battle. And no matter what you're going through, that should give you hope. It should put a small smile on your face. It doesn't take away all the pain. I'm not going to sit here and say it does. It's not going to necessarily, oh, all of a sudden $1,000 is going to show up in your bank account. But I pray today that you know that God is better than $1,000 in your bank account. That Jesus is better than feeling good for one day. That Jesus is better no matter what you're struggling. And he promises that he will fight every single battle for you if you just trust in him. So if you don't know this song yet, don't worry about it. I pray that as we get to the chorus, that it just catches on and it becomes an anthem. This is a powerful song. Anytime when I'm practicing a song and it brings me to tears, I just know, okay, God, I pray that this really speaks volumes to your people. Battle belongs.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see the mountain. Walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. Yeah. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So shine in the shadows. good. You turn it for good.
You take.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
You take. You take.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it.
Help us to stop trying to take control of our situations and help us to depend on you and your ways and your will. You are good, God. You are good. All we do sometimes is just mess things up. We think issues might not be big enough. They might not be important enough. We think we might have a better way, but God, you are bigger than it all. So help us to trust that you have the victory. And let our fighting truly take place on our knees. Let our fighting take place in song and in spirit. Let our fighting take place in serving one another in your name. We love you, God. Teach us this morning how to truly love. Teach us this morning how to be like you. Be with Pastor Rick as he just brings forth the message, and let that message change us for the good. We love you so much, God. Sing this one more time. So when I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high, oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I stand at your feet, Lord, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. It truly does. And all God's people said, amen.
Man, if that light gets any brighter, I'm going to get a tan up here this morning. I guess that's okay. I don't know for you if it was easy or hard getting out of bed this morning. How many found it really easy to get out of bed this morning? Okay, one, two, three. Okay, see, four. So we have, what, four liars here? No. It's easy. I got sucked into the World Series last. I'm just telling you what happened to me, and I couldn't turn it off, so I stayed up later than I normally do, so a little harder getting out of bed this morning. Of course, it begs the question, why get out of bed at all, right? Why bother getting up, brushing your teeth, or maybe not this morning, going to school or going to work, going to work out, or, you know, it sort of begs the question, you know, why bother at all, or why do life? Here's a contemporary philosophy attempting to answer that, and that is life's a pain and then you die. And that's what people, some folks think. It's sort of a philosophy that comes out of despair, or there is no real reason, or I got to pay the bills. You know, I want to stay out of jail. See, when Jesus was asked, what's the primary purpose for our existence, and that's an important question, right? Like, why? Why are we here? Why are any of us really here? Just to live a long time and have a good time? And when I can no longer have a good time? But his answer basically was to love God and love people. That's what he said. That's why we're here. Love God and love people with all you have, with all that you are, all the time. Never stop loving people and God, and get better as life continues. And you know, we're in 1 John here, and we've called it Let It Shine, and John keeps talking about love and the beloved and love and the beloved and loving, and it's like we've been in there for a while. We're in chapter 5, which is the last chapter, and it's like, John, if we haven't got it by now. With that, here's, I believe, a reality, and that is, people are not so much bothered about how they love, but how they are loved. And if we could just switch that to where I'm not so much bothered of how I am loved, but I'm bothered of how I love. We'd turn everything upside down. If we could just flip that. My accompanying thought is that when you are not loved well, and my guess is that there were times yesterday when you were not loved well, and there are probably times today where you are not loved well, and it just continues. So here's a great opportunity. When you are not loved well, be resolved that I will love well to make up for the love deficit. Now, maybe that sounds nuts, but where a lot of folks go, when I'm not loved well, I get angry, I get depressed, I take it out on others, and the lack of love has a ripple effect. So if we could just stop that and stop feeling so sorry for ourselves, yeah, I'm not loved well, but, or therefore, I am going to love well because what this world needs now, right? And what this church, what your family, what your relationship, what it needs now is this thing called love. And I know that's not how we normally think about it. You'll have to like retrain your mind where that clicks in. It's not normal. But if we could just do that,
So back to Jesus's commandment, basically love me and love people with all you have and all you are all the time. When we think about loving people, we know that people are messy. That we find some people are easier to love than others, but even the ones that are easier to love are not always easy to love. Because they have their days and their things and our wills clash. Yeah, how do you love someone who opposes you? That thinks different, that won't give in, that stand their ground? You know, what do you do with that? And not that they're mean and nasty, they're just going, no. We're not doing that, or I don't believe that. It can be a challenge. So we know that when it comes to folks or people, that love can be kind of haphazard. But how about loving God? I mean, that should be an easy one, right? Because, you know, God's like perfect. He gets it right all the time. You can argue with him, but you'll be wrong. And God's all loving. We know that. So how hard can it be to love a perfect, all-loving, righteous, incredibly awesome God? And then how do we know if we are really loving him or we just think we are? Which brings us to 1 John this morning. This is what he says here, just as we get into the chapter 5. He says, by this we know that we love the children of God. That would be us, if you're in Christ, if you've been saved and born again. This we know that we love when we love God. So how do we know when we're loving people or God's people? It's interesting where the priority of love for Christ followers are other Christians. Not that we don't love other on all people at all. It's not that, but the priority comes in loving the family of God. When we love the children of God, when we love God and we observe his commandments. My thought here is that there is virtually no difference between loving God and people. And when we don't love people, and especially people in the family of God, just rest assured that neither are you loving God very well. How we love people is how we're loving God. That's sort of the equal sign in there. And when we're not loving people, we're really not loving God. There's a challenge there. Either we're loving both or we're loving neither. It's an all or nothing. I said, this is what God says. I didn't make this up. And therefore, so how are we doing with loving God? How we know that is, how are we doing loving people? Next time you talk to God, that's called prayer, you can just ask him, God, what do I need to be and what do I need to do in order to be a more loving individual? Here's a question I think is critical. I ask it of myself, but I do not ask it nearly enough. Here's the question. What does love require of me? If you could just put that in your thought base. If you could just think that. I mean, we're always thinking certain things continually. If you could put that one and have that pop up to where instead of your mind dwelling on whatever, what does love, especially when you find it not easy to love another person, to then ask, what does love require of me? Not what does it require of them? We could spend all day with that one. And you can't, nothing you can do about that, but what does love require of me? Especially when I encounter someone that's not very loving. Yeah. We know, by this we know, we love the children of God when we love God and observe commandments. So, a couple thoughts, and that is, there is virtually, or loving God and loving people are directly linked to obeying His commandments. We can go over to this one here. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments. His commandments, they're not burdensome. Loving God and others is directly linked to keeping His commandments. God has never asked any of us to do anything. God tells us what to do, and God can tell us what to do because He is God Almighty. That's why they're called commandments. And maybe we have commandments here if you're in a certain position at work or at school. There's other folks who make commandments, and they're to be also to be paid attention to. But His commandments really are not optional. And so for this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and they're not burdensome. Regardless of how we think or feel. Back to John 14. He who has my commandments and keeps them, that is, obeys them, it is he it is who loves me, and he who loves me shall be loved by my Father, and I will love him and will disclose myself to him. Get this. It is he who has them and keeps them. The one who obeys God's commandments is the one who loves God. And this is interesting. And he who loves me shall be loved by my Father, and I will love him. Do you understand? There's this certain kind of godly love for the obedient. I'm not saying God doesn't love everyone, but there is a certain kind, there is a special kind of love that's only reserved for those who obey Him. God's love is always equal in every way. That is not correct. I'm not saying about levels. I don't think it's a level issue. I just know that when we obey Him, He loves us back in certain ways that His Father does and He does, of which He would not normally love us. So it's not, well, you know, I'm getting to heaven someday because I'm saved, so I'm going to go out and do whatever I want. I'm going to go and live it. I'm going to have a good time. I'm going to stay out late. I don't care. I'm just going to be me. I'm going to be real. So you don't want me to be a fake, do you? You want me to be a hypocrite, do you? So I'm just going to live like that. Just take it. And you know, what a misunderstanding of God's love and us loving Him. See, the one who says, I love God, but ignores God, doesn't love God. The one who thinks it's okay not to love people because they got this way or that way with me, and big deal. Well, it is a big deal. Because, you know, here again, you don't love people, you don't love God, and God won't have this, I call this special love for His, what I call, obedient children. So there's all, I mean, what a wonderful reason to love God and to love people and to obey His commands, because there's another kind of love that He has for those who keeps His commandments, that is, who loves Him, because if you say you love God but don't obey Him, you don't really. Now, I know we don't always get it right. I get that. But those who basically ignore it, give it up, and says, who cares? Well, God cares. I mean, I want to be loved in this special way by my Heavenly Father. I want to be loved in this special way by Jesus Himself. And he says this, and if you love me and my commandments, and you therefore we love you, I will show myself to you. I will disclose myself to them. I will show myself to you in ways that I otherwise wouldn't. You live in a certain reality of God that the disobedient people don't know of. I'm not saying they're not saved, not saying that. Not saying they're not children of God, not saying that. But they don't know God because God does not disclose or reveal himself to them the same way he does those who are obeying his commands. I don't know if that's a new thought, but I think it's an incredible thought. And if you're a parent, you know this is all already somewhat true between you and your children. If you're a parent, I don't care how many kids you have, you love all your kids, right? Say, yeah. Okay, yeah, yeah. You're sitting there thinking, well, you know. The answer is, yeah. Is it always easy to love your kids? Can I tell you this? No. Especially when they talk back. And they have the attitude, right? Any kid ever get the tood? Whenever they leave the room, they stomp off. Whenever they roll their eyes. Whenever they go, let out air. Whenever they slam the door. Whenever they say, sure, Boomer. Ever heard that? Yes, sir. I take that as an amen. Okay, Boomer. You know what they mean by that? What? Old people. Not only old, clueless people. Yeah. Old, clueless, archaic, like you got cobwebs for brains. Coming to the real, you know, all that stuff. Okay, Boomer. And they think it's funny, right? But sure, so it's not always easy, but you know you still love them. But don't you know that those that obey you, you know that you will bless them in certain ways that they would not otherwise be blessed, right? You know if you trust your children, you can entrust them with things that you would not otherwise. And so they're blessed in a different way. And I believe that's in some way the same way it is with God. Not that you're not his children, but if he knows he can't, if he knows you're going to misuse something, well, he probably won't let you have it. But if he knows that you're about glorifying him and you're living in submission to his will and his word, he will freely and abundantly give us things that he withholds from those who aren't. Hopefully that makes sense. I don't know exactly what it is, but sometimes I think it's a gift more of things of the character and the soul, inner things. Like the phrase goes, for it's things we have, but peace we lack. And you cannot increase your peace by increasing your things. And people don't know how to get peace, so oftentimes they run after and accumulate or accomplish or do certain things. Loving God is never described as a feeling or an emotion toward him, but rather an act of obedience. I know that sounds heavy sometimes, doesn't it? I gotta obey God. Oh, man. I don't know about that. See, God's older than a boomer, right? I don't know if he's really with it these days. I mean, that's how some people, I don't know.
He's an old fella. Bible is an old book. I'm not so sure. I'm not convinced. See, I've been given the task. Maybe I should say the opportunity to talk to the teens tonight. Oh, they're looking forward to that. You realize that Bobby, our youth guy, him and his wife had a baby. You guys know that? Yeah. That wasn't a lot of enthusiasm, but you know, okay, you don't have to. So he's off for a little while here, not too long. But I get an opportunity to talk, and I'm supposed to talk about to the teens about living their life, interacting with the Word of God. I don't know how to do it. I tell you, if you have any hints, you'll let me know, because I'm not really sure what to tell them. I know what to say, but I don't think they're going to do it, so I'm not sure what good it's going to do. Anyway, that's my problem, not yours. But if you don't interact with it, or if whenever you hear it, you just go sleepy time, I don't know how you can live it. You can't live it if you don't know it. Because the things of God don't just happen. They don't come naturally. It requires effort. So I don't know. Here's my ask this morning to everybody here. Would you just within yourself say, you know what? I am going to obey God's commands, all of them, not some of them, all the time, not some of the time. Can you just decide here, and I'm not looking for hands or nothing, but you know, within you, that for if you're not already there, you turn a corner. Yeah, that's what my life's going to be about. That's what I'm going to do. And here's the thing that I think are incredible. We just saw this in a previous verse, and it says, His commands are not burdensome. Because normally we think that His commands are. It's like, huh? I gotta do that. I don't want to do that. See, that's gonna jam me up. That's gonna cramp my style. Or that ain't me. Here's one. I'm not trying to pick on any particular thing, because various various commands that are out there, but one command, and you know this is true. You know it is. That the sexual relationship is only for those who are in the marital relationship. Meaning, if you're not married, that's out of bounds. That's not God's will. It's not His word. You don't have to go very far to go, oh, if you didn't know that, I hate to kind of spoil your party, but it's true. But here's where a lot of folks are at today. Nah, I know that, but there's the but. Therefore, I know I shouldn't, I know we shouldn't, but, you know, He understands. I don't know what that even means. Oh, He understands, all right. Well, financially, it makes good financial sense, and I want to be a good steward of God's money. Okay, so let's be a good steward of His money while we disobey His word. What? And I know I could be stepping on some toes. I know that. That's why you should always wear steel-toed shoes when you attend church. I'm just trying to give you a heads up. You know, I'm trying to simplify your life. Do you know how much simpler life would be if we just paid attention to that one? You understand? Do you know how much less regrets we would have? I did a wedding a week ago yesterday, 8 days ago. And I didn't ask what I think that the two people that I did the wedding for were both sexually pure. And that, man, they're nuts. But that's what I think. And I know that's not the norm. But what a joy, an added joy. Hey, and of course, if you crossed over the line, there's always grace and forgiveness, right? But don't ever get to the place where you go, you know, you throw in the towel. Yeah. Yeah, I know, but because he has a special love and grace for those that obey his commands. And his commandments are not, see, they feel like they are, but they're not. See, a burden is something we carry around with us, isn't it? I mean, if I was to ask this morning, anybody burdened here this morning? You're not looking for hands. But anybody burdened here this morning? And every head would go, yeah, I am. Does anybody feel like they have the weight of the world on their shoulders? I'm going, well, how do you know that? How long have you been carrying that all around? Long time. How's it feel? Not good. Would you like to lay it aside and never pick it up again? You mean I can? I can do that? Can. But it's in connection with his commandments because they're not burdensome. See, a burden is something we carry around with us that's heavy. You ever picked up a cinder block before? How many of you want to put a cinder block in each hand and just walk around all day? You know what you do when you pick up a cinder block? How quickly can I put this thing down? They're not any fun. I know some of you work construction. Some of you are doing some work maybe in your backyard, and you pick one of those things up, and they're heavy. Cinder blocks slow us down and wear us out. See, it's always heavier to live outside God's commandments than within God's commandments. If you want life to get heavy, really heavy, ignore God, ignore his commandments, and live however you want to. And one thing I'll guarantee you, it will not be a fun life. Because you will be worn down by carrying heavy stuff around. Maybe it's not a cinder block, but how about this? How about guilt? How about shame? How about regret? These we would like to unload, but we have not been able to, and you cannot if you continue to live outside his commandments. Because this is a truism. Sin is burdensome. His commandments aren't burdensome, but sin, it's burdensome. I know it looks like fun, and somewhat it is, or it wouldn't have this attraction. But sin is burdensome. It slows us down and it wears us out. It doesn't mean you can't be tired within God's will, but I guarantee you this, if you live outside of God's will, you will be tired. Because that's what sin does. So do yourself a favor. Live within the commandments. Why? They're not burdensome. That's why. Obedience to God's commands allow us to pick up the pace. They give us energy. Physical energy, yeah, I believe so, but more emotional energy. I mean, obedience to God is for God, but here's the great thing. We also benefit. The best thing you can do for yourself is live within His commands. They're not burdensome. Don't think, oh no, think, oh yeah, I didn't know that. So that's going to make my life, my load lighter? Yeah, it will. Didn't look that way, yeah, I know, but it does. See, with obedience, life gets lighter. I'm not saying that now you're going to have an easy life. You won't have any unnecessary burdens to carry around. It tends to lessen your stress load. Because I just know some of you are stressed. The needle is pegged. It's redlined. You don't know how much longer. And I don't know all the answers to all the issues you have on, but I want to do is say this. Live within His commands, and life does get lighter. Because His commandments, they're not burdensome. Truly, they're not. That's what He says. It gets lighter. You don't have to live with this huge burden anymore. The heaviness of whatever. It's unnecessary. You know, obey God. I know you won't always get it right. I know. God's commands are a gift of grace to His people. You look at it like that. His command, what He tells us to do, it's a gift of grace. And they're not heavy. Loving God and loving others is not a heavy. When you do, you'll find life gets lighter. I'm going to tell you this, and it's not, please hear me, it's not to make me look good, but it was Thursday. And I'm at Walmart, and there's two ladies in front of me, and I don't know, maybe my age, a little bit older, and they had a few things, and I had quite a few things stacked up behind them, and I'm just, they're ready to check out, and I says, are you going to pay for my stuff too? And they looked at me, well, you know, no. And I said, well, since you're not going to pay for my stuff, I'm going to pay for your stuff. And I had my card out, put it in there, and they looked at me, and I don't think they could believe what I was doing. And by the way, I don't do this very often, so don't follow me around Walmart. Oh, with all going on in this world today, we just need to be kind to one another. And I said this, and it makes me feel good. Now, before I did that, I kind of saw how much the amount was, you know, because I didn't want to feel too good. So I paid, and they're about like almost tearing up. And so I started to check out, and she had some card. She said, well, let me do something for you. I go, no. I didn't do that to get something. I just, I just know when I do that, I feel good, and hopefully you're blessed and these things. She goes, you don't get it. I work for Walmart. I get a 10% discount. I said, hold on. Got another car, loaded her up. No, I didn't do that. I was done. She swipes her card. Here's the neat thing. The discount I got was greater than the amount I paid for her. And then she went across the where you check out, and there were people she didn't even know. She goes, you know what? I'm swiping yours too. Boom. And these people are going like, ah, this lady, she just gave it to me. And they're just going like this. And going, isn't that the way? I should do that more. I should. But it was just a way of trying to promote some kindness, maybe a little bit of love. You don't have to know them. And you know what? That alone made my days. And there's different ways to do things like that. Anyway, with obedience, life gets lighter. Here we go. Love God, love people. Light it up. Let it shine. Would you pray with me? Lord, thank you so much for your goodness to us. You're a tremendous God. May we live knowing that your commandments are not burdensome. They take the burdens away. Life is lighter. And when we know it is, when we know that it only benefits you, it benefits us, why wouldn't we go and live there? Thank you this morning for loving us, being our God. We want to live the burden-free life. We pray it now in Christ's name. Amen.
Please stand with us as we close out the service. And as Rick was talking and was talking about burdens, there was probably some people out there listening and like probably even thinking, wow, you know, I don't smoke, I don't drink, I don't cuss, I don't sleep outside of wedlock, I give to the church every day, I serve. Why is my life still a mess? But I think it comes down to redefining what burden is actually meaning to us. Is that equal to what God determines a burden? I mean, I look at, it's funny when he was talking about his commandments are not burdensome. Like, I have 6 kids because of God's word. That's a burden. And it's hard sometimes. And he gave me a worship leader salary. And it's like, come on. But he was right when it's like, I do. I have this joy, even amidst the midst of the chaos. And for those of you who don't know, the 4 younger ones are all drug exposed. And so like just the issues that come with that. And it's rough and it's hard. But yet I don't feel burdened by it. And then I got to thinking of King David. He is literally standing right beside his enemy, Saul. All he had to do was kill him, right? He was taking a leak, for crying out loud. And he just had to kill him. But God said, no, do it my way. And David probably was like, I don't understand. This is this obvious, simple way. So the burdens actually have to equal his ways are higher than ours. We don't always understand it, and we need to be okay with that. And when we fall madly in love with Christ, our thoughts, our ways don't mean anything. And all of a sudden, his ways become a joy to actually follow. So as we sing this, no longer slaves, I pray that that's exactly what we're praying over. That whatever burden you're calling a burden, even if it's in the midst of God's will, that God can open up our eyes and our hearts to understand it is truly a joy to follow in His ways. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Longer a slave to fear. child of God, singing once more. I hear a child of God. Heavenly Father, God, we are your children. And as your children, we screw up. But God, let it never be the norm. Let us never just say we've screwed up enough. It's just, it's okay in your eyes. God, let us continue to strive to be more and more like you every single day. In your love, in your grace, in your mercy, in your ways. You are good. And we love you and we praise you. Let us leave this place shining your light to all that we see. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen. Have a wonderful week. Go and shine that light. God bless. We'll see you next week.